already for 6 years. We as a firm have a close relationship as Deloitte University with MIT Sloan. For 6 years, we try to get a feel of what the digital DNA of the world looks like. And let me just share with you where we currently stand. So this is the global research. And here's the numbers. We describe basically three stages of maturity. And it's important to understand the basic question that we use. We can't just have a thermometer and say, okay, you're this. That's difficult. So what we do as an opening question, one of 52 questions, is if you were to compare your digital DNA in terms of maturity to the best in class in your industry that might not even exist in your industry yet, how would you rate on a scale of 1 to 10? And this is what you get. 25% says early. 34%, 41% says developing and maturing is 25 and developing is, early is 34. Now, the good news for the Netherlands is this one. Already for a number of years, we see a trend which basically comes down to these numbers. So in comparison in the Netherlands, our early group is relatively low. The middle group, developing, is definitely 10% bigger. And what is really interesting is that the maturing group is also bigger. So for a long time, colleagues of mine and I have discussed, what is this? We want to better understand this. And there's something else in the global research that we'll touch upon later when we have our discussion here on this stage. And that is this one. If there's one thing that makes clear that successful DNA in terms of digital DNA is successful because there is a strategy behind it. It is integrated into the overall strategy of the firm. It is not a quote-unquote sidekick. And so 9 months ago, when we started our conversation with the team that prepared this event, we had a discussion with my colleagues of strategic consulting, of digital, of technology, of human capital. And we asked ourselves the question, you know, what is it that we apparently do a few things better? We want to understand. But we also had a feeling that we needed to know more. Because the perception was, first of all, there is not one road to Rome. And secondly, why go to that road and Rome in the first place? So the first step we took was quantitative research. So qualitative research. So we started out by interviewing 11 of our customers. Stephen Ward and myself, together with an intern, did a lot of those interviews. Some of those people are actually in this room. Top customers of Deloitte. 2.5 hour interviews. Really understand, what are you doing? What is the strategy behind it? What works and what doesn't work? The second step we took was, we took a look at our portfolio. Because obviously, the nature of what we do as a consulting firm is that we are close to our customers. We are also in the kitchen. So we can ask questions in the kitchen. We can understand basically the menu and how it is prepared. And from the combined analysis of the interviews and the type of jobs we were engaging with, the type of proposals we were asked to submit, we concluded there is not one type, one road, there is four archetypes. And then obviously we got lucky. We got lucky because we have a wonderful database, which is jointly owned by MIT and Deloitte. 3,500 executives, senior managers across the world with an interest in digital. And so we did what we tell our customers to do. Take the existing data and let some of our smart tools do some of the searching. And then obviously to do that searching, you need to have some idea of what you're looking for. So we took the 52 questions that you would probably find in the MIT report. We are going to send that to you. And we took the terms, the type of questions that were asked, and we clustered them. Because some questions are a bundle of questions about leadership, about talent. So we brought them together in such a way that we ended up at the end with a total of 13 different categories. We called them digital DNA. These are the things that distinct your company in terms of how to organize for digital transformation. And the second thing we did, taking the assumption of the archetypes that we had defined from our qualitative research, we put them into an order. And this is the order that we found. On the bottom, and I'll dive into each of them individually, you'll find laggards. That in the world is 23%. The next group we defined is chasers, 26%. Then fast-moving experimenters, and finally, talent and strategy-led. The higher you go, the more value, the more success you see on based on the data that we have. So basically, what you're talking about is a tree. At the bottom, there's laggards. On top of that is chasers. And then, interestingly enough, there's two strategies that are fundamentally different in the composition of the DNA that is applied. The whole premise behind this is you can't be good at everything. You have to choose your own configuration. Now, the good news for the Netherlands is this. This group of fast-moving experimenters is 31%, which, as compared to the former slide, makes up this difference. We are doing some things really good, relatively speaking, in this country. Now, let's just dive into each of these different archetypes. Again, the list of characteristics, DNA strands, as Andrew would call them, are always the same. It's 13, and they are reconfigured because of the above average or below average score that you have. And what we saw in the laggards category is that they are probably, the best word in Dutch would be onbewust onbekwaam. No plan, no idea, no money. It might be that they are in a category in which they are protected by a certain market situation or a certain, let's say, niche. Let's go to the next group. This is an interesting group and also a worrying group. It is 1/3 of our sample in the Netherlands and almost 1/3 in the rest of the world. What distinguishes them from all the others is that they're not good either, but they're spending a lot of money. They're throwing money against the wall, which is good for a consulting firm, by the way. They're throwing a lot of money against the wall, and they hope something will stick. But since they don't have a strategy, and they don't know what to measure because they don't have a strategy, they're oblivious. If you don't know where you're going to, that road is not going to get you there as well. And now we come to the successful formula. There's two successful formulas. The one, and that is the big surprise from our analysis, is fast-moving experimenters. In this country, we have an appetite for trying out new stuff. We're open for that. And I'm sure that some of you in the audience that are non-Dutch see that in us. You must see that in us. We are open to the world. But there's also another side. When you zoom into it, you find, for instance, that Dutch fast-moving experimenters have a huge number of initiatives. In an earlier interview in my former job in Gartner, I referred to this as pilots and polder. A lot of shit going on, but not scaling it. And the second one, I'm sure you will recognize as well, which is that they are think of themselves as being very good at this. It's a self-assessment. Now, the interesting thing that Jan Bonnier, the editor-in-chief of the Financieel Dagblad will share with us later that the research that he and his team did together with Vlerik also came out with a relatively positive result, right, John? Which is interesting because it's not in our nature to say that that's true. So it got a lot of criticism. So let's just assume that they're lying, but at least they're lying in conjunction. Now, let's go to the next one. And I'm sure that in this room, a lot of you would probably recognize themselves as part of this DNA. The group is more or less the same in terms of numbers, but they share a number of characteristics that are typically for the success of this group. The first one is talent-driven, meaning to say investment in recruiting talent, getting new DNA into the organization, raising that. To a degree, I think we are like that in Deloitte. Secondly, not just do that with the newbies, but also educate the existing team to make sure that the whole company is taken to the next level. Third one, no surprise, there is a long-term strategy. Zoom in, zoom out, know where you're going to. And finally, there is strong leadership. We want to go there, with or without you. There is a downside in the Netherlands to this profile. And I am sure you, the Dutchies, will recognize it. The first one is this one. The acceptance of risk in the Netherlands is 13% lower in this group than in the rest of the world. And the second one, to make it even worse, is that the organization's encouragement to experiment is minus 23%. And that is an odd one, because if your top DNA is all about talent and recruitment and growing talent, you're never going to grow talent when you don't allow people to fail or to experiment. So, what makes this research and this perspective interesting as far as my teammates and I are concerned? When you go by the metaphor of DNA, then the set of DNA strings is limited. You have to do with what you have to do. So going back to the dogs that Andrew referred to, okay, I want the next generation of my dog a longer tail. Right. Choose a longer tail to mate with and start working on that. In other words, don't take all the DNA of the other success formula. Just try and define which strand would be the most interesting one, the most promising one, given who I am, the markets that I support, to copy into my organization. So here you look from the talent and strategy leaders' perspective, and I'm mirroring that to the fast experimenters. You could say, you might want to do some more experimenting. You could say, maybe some more leadership. That's a debate to have. Let's reverse the same data, but from a different perspective. So now we're looking at the same picture, the same data, from the perspective of the fast experimenters. This is their DNA. This is how they have organized themselves. And now we're putting against that the fast experimenter side. And there you see it. On that side of the, if you're a fast experimenter, the thing to copy from the talent side is the talent management and how you deal with that. So for everybody in this room, there will be different configuration of this. But the data that we have illustrate there's different configurations to be chosen in terms of digital DNA. And it is useful to understand how these things relate to each other. So somewhere next week, you will receive our report. It's an extensive report. It dives into all kinds of dimensions. And it is an attempt to get a real feel of what digital DNA is all about. So now let's discuss with a number of people that I've invited, or we have invited to this audience, what this research is telling us.